At the start of 2024, Rock, the Dwayne Johnson, pulled off a piece of political scheming that would have had Machiavelli himself go, "Fairer play, son, a fairer play." Johnson had successfully negotiated a position on the board of WWE's parent company, TKO, and loads of shares in it, ownership of the Rock intellectual property, and, according to some, the main event of WrestleMania XL. In one fell swoop, The Rock had become head of WWE creative Pool of X biggest star, and his boss, Triple H, once thought to have been pro wrestling's most successful backstage politician, just found himself between a rock and well, another rock. But it wasn't always this way. In fact, it was the total opposite. Unlike other top guy politicians in wrestling's past, like Hulk Hogan and Shawn Michaels, The Rock stood out in the WWF because he refused to play the game. So what happened? The quick answer is Hollywood. Hollywood happened. The longer answer is this video. I'm Oli Davis, and this is The Rock's WWE Takeover, politicking in movies, wrestling, and beyond. Chapter 1. The Good Attitude Era. As soon as Pat Patterson saw a 24-year-old Dwayne Johnson wrestle in a tryout match, he instantly recognized a main event star. As Vince McMahon's right-hand man, Patterson fast-tracked Dwayne to his WWF debut later that year, where he'd introduce the gimmick that would launch him into superstardom. The Blue Chipper Rocky Maivia, complete with tassels. So many blue tassels. The Rock later said that he was initially apprehensive about the gimmick, but Vince McMahon and Jim Ross convinced him it was a good idea. He would do what he was told, with minimal pushback, which would remain his attitude for the next decade plus. After a negatively received one-dimensional babyface run, where many felt he was overpushed, he returned from injury in 1997, turned heel, and debuted the Rock gimmick. By 1998, he was the most electric man in all of sports entertainment. Between then and 2002, he won the WWE Championship 7 times, had a whole new show named after his catchphrase, SmackDown, and had a WrestleMania trilogy against Stone Cold Steve Austin. But despite either being the top or joint top guy with Austin for the 6 prime Attitude Era years from 97 to 2002, The Rock had one of the lowest win percentages out of the entire main event scene. I spent way too long on the wrestling database cage match and compared the records of who I see as the 8 top stars of the Attitude Era. I use singles match results from pay-per-view or TV episodes only, not house shows, to find out what their average winning percentage was. Kurt Angle, who I could only use from his debut in 99, surprisingly had the highest at 66.75%. Triple H, unsurprisingly, was next, followed by The Undertaker, Kane, Stone Cold Steve Austin, and Chris Jericho, who spent 2 of those years in WCW. And then, second from rock bottom, is Dwayne Johnson, with a 52.95% winning average. The only top Attitude Era star lower was Mick Foley, whose entire gimmick was getting beaten up and losing. As noted philosopher Scott Steiner once said, the numbers don't lie. But what are the stories behind some of those losses? At No Mercy 2000, The Rock lost the WWF Championship to a rookie Kurt Angle, cementing Angle as a main event star. Kurt even later said, The Rock was never political. He never got involved with any of the finishes. He always did what he was told to do, and that's what I loved about Rock. He always took the high road and never tried to go behind somebody's back and get a finish changed. Triple H, for comparison, reportedly tried to sabotage Angle's push behind the scenes, successfully lobbying for the Stephanie Kurt romance angle to be dropped after that year's SummerSlam. At Vengeance 2001, Chris Jericho defeated The Rock and Stone Cold in the same night, which didn't have the best follow-up, but the intention was there to make a new star. Triple H, for comparison, is believed to have got Jericho pulled from his first WrestleMania main event the year before, according to Jericho himself. And at SummerSlam 2002, The Rock lost the WWE Undisputed title to rookie Brock Lesnar, making Lesnar the then youngest WWE champion ever. Stone Cold had actually walked out of the company in the build to that match, refusing to put over Lesnar in the King of the Ring tournament, although he had his own reasons, thinking that should be a bigger occasion, not just a throwaway match on Raw. Like Jericho and Angle said, WWF's main event stars in the Attitude Era were fiercely protective of their spots and would use their backstage influence to bury other people's pushes. The Rock, however, just did whatever the company thought was best. Apart from Shawn Michaels. Apparently The Rock legitimately hated Shawn Michaels because HBK had disrespected his wrestling promoter grandmother a decade before at a Hawaii show. Which is why we never got a Rock versus Michaels match. But still, he never buried Michaels, he just refused to work with him. But main eventers is one thing. There's a self-interested argument that you want to make new top stars out of Jericho or Lesnar or Angle so you can make more money when you beat them in the rematch. I bet The Rock didn't care about lowly mid-carders and buried them all the time. Yeah, but just one more thing. The Rock did use his political sway when working with wrestlers lower down the card, but it was to help them. The Hurricane recalled a story on Talk Is Jericho about when he beat The Rock in March 2003, albeit from more Stone Cold shenanigans. Apparently, The Rock and Hurricane were both due to record some promos for the show, but Rock intentionally kept messing up his lines so they would have to do them live, meaning The Rock could go on for as long as he wanted to try and put The Hurricane over more. By all accounts, the Attitude Era Rock was a stand-up guy behind the scenes, intensely charismatic, yet without ego, high up the card, but willing to help out those beneath him. I'm sure those traits will really help him when he pursues acting full-time in Hollywood. I'm being sarcastic. They won't. Hollywood eats people like that for cheat day. Chapter 2. Fast and Furious and Fallouts. There's this theory that naturally pretty and talented people don't really know how hard the world is. That's why I find life so easy. From the moment Johnson started wrestling with his natural talent and beaming smile, a support system quickly formed around him to help him succeed. And when you've got that kind of support, it lets you be unselfish, because you'll keep getting main event opportunities. But that means there might have been some naivety in transitioning to Hollywood, where no such reverence for The Rock's wrestling dynasty or his athletic abilities existed. If anything, back in the early noughties, being a pro wrestler turned actor was heavily looked down upon. Oh, how far the chaperone has brought us! At that time, there were only really two pathways for an action movie star. Number one, do action movies and then go family-friendly, a la Hulk Hogan's Mr. Nanny or Arnold Schwarzenegger's Kindergarten Cop. Or two, do action movies and then keep making action movies, but for the direct-to-DVD market, like Steve Austin or Steven Seagal. The Rock, however, seemed to straddle both. After starring in big-budget movies The Mummy Returns and The Scorpion King in 2001 and 2, he had a run of increasingly smaller-scale action films, Walking Tall, To Doom, To Snitch, which he interspersed with family films The Game Plan, Race to Witch Mountain, and The Tooth Fairy. But even spreading his bets couldn't stop the seeming decline. The longer he spent away from wrestling in the noughties, the more his star power dwindled. In 2011, he had decided to return to WWE as the host of WrestleMania 27. Thankfully for Johnson, this was when he came across another brand that was kind of running out of gas. Could have laughed there, Pete. Silence. In 2001, the same year The Rock would make his Hollywood debut in The Mummy Returns, the Fast and Furious franchise launched. Its beginnings were relatively modest compared to what it would become, starting with a normal-sized cast and physics that obeyed the laws of nature, centering around an undercover cop infiltrating an illegal street racing scene. That movie launched a franchise that saw the entire cast leave for the third movie, but it was the fifth film that would launch the series, sometimes literally, into space, with Fast Five, and the inclusion of its hottest new character, Luke Hobbs, played by The Rock. The movie made over $600 million worldwide, more than the first three films combined, and Rock's Hobbs effectively became the franchise's co-headliner with Vin Diesel. Fast and Furious 6 would make even more, with $788 million. Furious 7 somehow almost doubled that, pulling in $1.5 billion. And the fate of the Furious, the fate there meaning 8, I love the Fast and Furious franchise, but I hate their titles, drew $1.2 billion. After toiling in the relative movie indies for a decade, The Rock suddenly found himself as the world's most bankable film star. His Jumanji reboot did $962 million, Disney's Moana pulled in $643 million, you're welcome! Even standard action fare like San Andreas or Rampage would make almost half a billion dollars if you put Dwayne Johnson on the poster. In 2016, 19, 20, and 21, Rock was the highest paid actor in the world, according to Forbes. But despite the Fast and Furious franchise being all about family, The Rock's monumental success happened at the same time as a rift between him and its original top guy, Vin Diesel. In August 2016, during The Rock's final week shooting Fate of the Furious, he called out his male co-stars for being unprofessional. In a now-deleted Facebook and Instagram post, Dwayne said, "My female co-stars are always amazing and I love them. My male co-stars, however, are a different story. Some conduct themselves as stand-up men and true professionals, while others don't. The ones that don't are too chicken shit to do anything about it anyway. Candy asses. When you watch the movie next April and it seems like I'm not acting in some of these scenes and my blood is legit boiling, you're right. Bottom line is it'll play great for the movie and fits this Hobbs character that's embedded in my DNA extremely well." Days after these posts, a well-placed source told the Wrestling Observer, I mean Entertainment Tonight, that they were aimed at Diesel. Vin had allegedly upset many cast and crew members by repeatedly showing up late to shoots, something which, according to the source, Dwayne never did. So The Rock decided to create a breakaway faction. Just a week after the release of that eighth Fast and Furious movie, Deadline reported there were plans for a spin-off film where, in typical wrestling booking fashion, the sworn enemies would form a tag team to take on a bigger opponent. It was to be called Hobbs and Shaw, as it would only be centered around The Rock and Jason Statham's characters, and the rest of the family would be left out, which prompted Rock's co-star Tyrese Gibson to post in September 2017 on Instagram. If you move forward with that Hobbs movie, you will have purposely ignored the heart-to-heart moment we had in my sprinter. I don't want to hear from you until you remember what we talked about. I'm on your timeline because you're not responding to my text messages. Fast Family is just that, a family. We don't fly solo. And a few weeks later, Tyrese posted again. Congratulations to The Rock and your brother-in-law, aka 7 Bucks producing partner, for making the Fast and the Furious franchise about you. Fast Family, right? Nah, it's about Team Dwayne. The Rock would release Hobbs and Shaw, which also starred his tribal chief cousin Roman Reigns, in 2019, pulling in $760 million. This behind-the-scenes tension resulted in The Rock leaving the franchise altogether, with him telling The Hollywood Reporter in 2021, "I wish them well on Fast 9, and I wish them the best of luck on Fast 10 and Fast 11, and the rest of the Fast and Furious movies they do that will be without me." Without The Rock, Fast 9 had to add another member to their 87-actor-strong cast, who just so happened to be The Rock's famous pro wrestling rival, John Cena. I'm sure Cena's casting is totally unrelated to whatever happened with The Rock. Fast 9, whether it was because they no longer had The Rock coming out of lockdown, or because it was the ninth film in a franchise, only made $726 million. Still a massive success, but $500 million less than its predecessor. Maybe sensing they were stronger together than apart, Diesel publicly called for Rock to rejoin the cast for the 10th movie, saying that he'd made a promise to the late Paul Walker, the franchise's original co-star, who had tragically died in a car accident, and that Vin's children refer to The Rock as Uncle Dwayne. The Rock did not appreciate that approach, though, as he told CNN. Vin's recent public post was an example of his manipulation. I didn't like that he brought up his children in the post as well as Paul Walker's death. Leave them out of it. We had spoken months ago about this and came to a clear understanding. So naturally, The Rock made a surprise cameo in the end credits of the 10th Fast and Furious movie. Spoiler, with Rock sharing news on Twitter not long after the movie's release. The next Fast and Furious film you'll see the legendary lawman in will be the Hobbs movie that will serve as a fresh, new chapter and setup for Fast 10 Part 2. Last summer, Vin and I put all the past behind us. I'm not coming down on either side of the rift here. I'm laying out what happened with the Fast and Furious franchise to see how it might have affected The Rock's future decision-making. Unlike in WWE, where he was happy to go out there and do his job, sometimes the job, maybe Dwayne realized to continue his success, he'd need to wield as much behind-the-scenes power as his characters did on screen. Which brings us to one of the most mismanaged pieces of intellectual property of recent times, the DC Extended Universe. Before we get into that though, here's a word from this video's sponsors. Us! Sign up at patreon.com/WrestleTalk and you'll get access to our exclusive deep dive show WrestleTalk Extra, where Luke and I are exploring the breakup of The Shield and all the other craziness that happened in 2014 WWE. Here's a clip.
There's only one thing that we need to talk about here, and that's Blue Tista.
Blue Tista.
Yeah. That is Dave.
You've got to get into this.
Dave blew himself. It's the funniest because Triple H and Randy will come out in their cool black trunks. Ooh, we're so cool. And there's baby Blue Batista with his hair all grown out and his beard, and he's got this long arm pads on, and he just, look at
Let's
him.
Let's get a picture.
Let's get a picture of it.
Chapter 3, Rock versus Superman. Way back in 2007, New Line Cinema were developing a movie based on DC's magical superhero, Shazam, and they were in talks with Rocky to play the character's arch-nemesis, Black Adam, who The Rock was such a big fan of, he thought was called Black Atom.
Up and Atom.
Up and at them.
The project was stuck in developmental limbo when New Line Cinema was absorbed by Warner Bros. But upon seeing the success of Marvel's cinematic universe, DC decided they'd do it themselves, but way worse, announcing their own extended universe with Shazam in its official lineup, and The Rock still set for the role of Black Adam. But this wasn't 2007 anymore, and thanks to the Fast and Furious franchise, The Rock was now one of the biggest stars on the planet. Warner Bros. Executives were worried about casting someone so popular as a villain and not the lead, especially because both of their movies by that point, Batman v Superman and Suicide Squad, were critical disasters. So after a meeting in January 2017, it was decided Shazam would be split into two films, Shazam and Black Adam, with The Rock's own production company making the latter. Oh yeah, The Rock had his own production company by this point. Founded in 2012 with his ex-wife Danny Garcia, Seven Bucks Productions had been making TV shows like The Hero and Ballers. But around the same time The Rock shot on his Fast and Furious co-stars in 2016, the company moved into producing Rock-led movies, with Baywatch as its first fiction feature. Perhaps frustrated as an actor in someone else's production, he decided to do it himself. Jumanji, Rampage, Skyscraper, Fighting With My Family, then Shazam, then Hobbs and Shaw, Seven Bucks was on a run of making decently received, commercially successful movies. DC, however, just couldn't replicate the magic that was working for Marvel. Aquaman, Birds of Prey, Wonder Woman were all fun, but they lacked the coherent universe that was driving audiences to see any film with MCU plastered on top of it. DC needed a leader, and The Rock wanted it to be him. And if you're The Rock at this time, there is a very compelling case you are the guy for the job. Highest paid actor in the world? Check. Provable draw in an action film franchise? Check. A bankable history of movie production? Check. A brand so strong you can just launch your own tequila and sell 600,000 cases in its first year? Check. DC arguably needed The Rock more than The Rock needed DC, and he used that leverage to attempt to control the entire franchise's creative direction, a creative direction that he envisioned being built around him. Yes, that does sound like every wrestling promoter you've ever heard of. Using his pro wrestling smarts, The Rock's long-term vision for DC was to build to a WrestleMania-level main event. Gone was the original plan of Shazam and Black Adam having their own solo movies to build to a versus one. Shazam was just a mid-carder. As a pro wrestler, The Rock wanted the biggest match possible. He wanted Black Adam versus Superman. I think mine and The Rock's interpretations of the Black Adam character are quite different. I've been reading DC for over a quarter of a century, including the Black Adam redefining arc in the 52 series. Here, my omnibus copies of said storyline, these right here, are why Davis was finding off the ladies in his early 20s. So cool. So hot. To me, Teth Adam, that's what his friends call him, is a super violent villain but with a consistent moral code, prioritizing the Middle Eastern country he rules over everything else, like Dr. Doom and Latveria in Marvel. There's something noble about that, right? Even if it does lead him very often to do some very bad things and aligning himself with some very bad people. But I've always felt that The Rock saw Black Adam as the Scorpion King. And even when he was supposed to be building a match against Shazam, he was still posting about taking on Superman. As a kid, Superman was the hero I always wanted to be, but a few years into my fantasy, I realized that Superman was the hero I could never be. I was too rebellious, too rambunctious, too resistant to convention and authority. Despite my troubles, I was still a good kid with a good heart. I just liked to do things my way. Now, years later, as a man with the same DNA I had as a kid, my superhero dreams have come true. I'm honored to join the iconic DC Universe, and it's a true pleasure to become Black Adam. Black Adam is blessed by magic with the powers equal to Superman, but the difference is he doesn't toe the mark or walk the line. He's a rebellious, one-of-a-kind superhero who'll always do what's right for the people, but he does it his way. Truth and justice. The Black Adam way. It meant we never really got a Black Adam movie that honored the comics. We got The Scorpion King 6. Yes, you heard me right. There have been 4 other Scorpion King direct-to-DVD movies since the original, none of which star The Rock. Although, Untitled Reboot is in development, produced by, guess who? Dwayne Johnson. The Rock teased something big was up in his official filming rap post on Black Adam on Instagram, saying, "The hierarchy of power in the DC universe is changing." You could take that post to refer to the character of Black Adam, but it also reflected what was reportedly going on behind the scenes. Deadline reported in 2023, following DC owners Warner Bros. Merging with Discovery, that The Rock went around DC executives to go right to the very top, pitching his vision of a multi-year Black Adam vs. Superman saga to the company's new CEO, David Zaslav. The same David Zaslav who supposedly once called CM Punk One Bill Phil. This was thought to be The Rock and his team making a play to take control of the DC movieverse. The Rock also allegedly pushed for a producing credit on DC League of Super Pets, even though he reportedly did very little producing or promoting of the movie, and also allegedly turned down cameo appearances in the second Shazam movie and the Flash movie, which is kind of the movie equivalent of saying you're not going to put over Chris Jericho and Kurt Angle. Perhaps Rock didn't want his Black Adam to be tainted by those tortured projects. It was Shazam Fury of the Gods. Next week, in Winnipeg. It was enough for The Rock to get his wish. even though the previous DC Films head had made the call in 2018 to find a new actor to play the role, Henry Cavill returned as Superman in the post-credits scene for Black Adam. Cavill, coincidentally, was managed by Danny Garcia, Rock's ex-wife and business partner. The attempted power grab didn't go down well inside DC, but if Black Adam was a success, perhaps that wouldn't matter. Unfortunately for The Rock, the movie was badly received both commercially and critically, making only $391 million from a $235 million budget. A Hollywood Reporter noted it would be lucky to break even. Deadline later reported that Black Adam would ultimately turn a profit of $52 to $72 million, but even that's questionable, as a later report claims several Warner executives suspected The Rock's team of inflating the numbers and sending inaccurate figures to save face. Inflating numbers? Rock, stop being so pro-wrestling! With The Rock's increasing demands, Warner Bros. Discovery decided the returns on using him just weren't there anymore, meaning the end for the fantasy booking of Rock versus Superman on the big screen. Henry Cavill officially announced he was leaving the Superman role entirely, and DC would instead go with James Gunn to lead their creative direction moving forward. Gunn would later tell The Hollywood Reporter he believed Cavill was getting dicked around by a lot of people, including the former regime at this company. The same time, Cavill split from his long-term manager, Danny Garcia, who again is The Rock's ex-wife and business partner, where The Sun claimed Henry and Danny have worked together for years, but recently things haven't been going as smoothly. Things have become muddled. Gunn also announced that Black Adam would not be factored into the new look DC going forward, and two high-level Hollywood insiders told The Wrap, "Dwayne tries to sell himself as bigger than the movie. He's one of the few people who always thinks he's the most important person in any situation or room." In one of those delicious bits of irony, one of the only actor-character combos James Gunn confirmed will stay on in his new DC was again The Rock's famous pro wrestling rival, John Cena, meaning Cena has kind of now replaced Rock in his two main franchises. For what it's worth, The Rock still maintains that Black Adam was a success, and has said publicly that the only reason a sequel isn't being made is because it got caught up in a vortex of leadership, which is different to the vortex of mid-card ship. The Rock explained this viewpoint on Kevin Hart's podcast. It's like new ownership coming in and buying an NFL team going, "All right, not my head coach, not my quarterback, doesn't matter how many times we won the Super Bowl, doesn't matter how many rings we got, I'm going with somebody else." The Rock there seemingly forgetting he had not won the Super Bowl, he'd made Black Adam. For a full decade in Hollywood, The Rock could do no wrong. Even Baywatch made money, but had now been kicked off his big superhero franchise. A personal rift had broken him away from Fast and Furious. His TV show Young Rock was cancelled after three seasons, and his films like Red Notice and Jungle Cruise were becoming increasingly expensive and negatively received. So why not return to the place where he had enough influence to control his own destiny? Why not finally go back home? Chapter 4, Hollywood Rock in WWE. The Rock and Ari Emanuel, the CEO of Endeavor, TKO's parent company, which owns WWE, have been friends for years. The Rock was even a client of Endeavor's WME agency for almost 13 years, and going back even longer was Rock's friendship with now WWE president Nick Khan, who he'd been friends with since childhood. Nick's sister Nanachka was also a co-creator of The Rock's Young Rock TV series. So in January 2024, it was announced Dwayne Johnson joined TKO's board of directors. In return, he would receive the rights to his Rock name and catchphrases, which he would license back to WWE for them to make money from. $30 million worth of TKO stock, giving him a literal slice of pie. And some reports claimed he was promised the main event of WrestleMania 40 against Roman Reigns.
Does a Superman punch? It's the same thing.
Unlike Hollywood, The Rock could now be a property's biggest star and control that company from the very top. The problem was the head of creative, Triple H, and the millions of WWE fans had already decided Roman's WrestleMania opponent. Cody Rhodes. 5 days after Rock was announced as a TKO director, Rhodes won the Men's Royal Rumble match and clearly pointed at Reigns as his choice. But on the following episode of SmackDown, The Rock turned up, whispered something to Cody, and took Rhodes' place. The live crowd loved it. Everyone else? Not so much. There were a lot of conflicting reports coming out during this time. Some say The Rock was promised a Mania main event against Reigns as part of his TKO deal. Others said WWE, or even The Rock himself, were just trying to use it as a scapegoat to distract from the negative Vince McMahon allegations coverage. Yet more claimed it was WWE and The Rock's clumsy but well-intentioned effort to save WrestleMania, with CM Punk and Seth Rollins both injured and Brock Lesnar out due to controversy. But it's not like this is the only time this has happened. Back in 2013, WWE booked The Rock to beat CM Punk for the WWE Championship to set up a rematch against John Cena at WrestleMania 29 for the title. Like Punk famously said in his 2011 pipe bomb, Cena might have been good at kissing Vince McMahon's ass. I don't know if you're as good as Dwayne, though. He's a pretty good ass kisser. Always was, and still is. But in 2024, The Rock and WWE lent in to the negative fan reaction they created and used it to fuel something even greater, turning Rock heel, joining the bloodline, reinforcing that Samoan dynasty heritage, reverting back to what fans wanted to see. We have a whole video dedicated to the entire Samoan dynasty family tree explained, by the way. You can check that out in the video description. The Rock got his WrestleMania main event, teaming with Reigns against Cody and Seth Rollins on night one, to be involved in the Reigns vs. Rhodes match, main eventing night two. The word politicking gets a bad name. It's usually used for nefarious self-interested plots from the likes of Machiavelli, Game of Thrones' Littlefinger, or, most devilishly of all, Triple H. But sometimes, when the results of politicking are so enjoyable, people don't tend to refer to it by that name. While the initial Cody replacement booking was badly judged, The Rock pivoted and then used his corporate position and on-screen character to get away with things no other WWE wrestler was allowed to, from going overtime in his segments to frequently using profanity on TV despite it being a PG product. But it makes for great sports entertainment. The Rock's uniquely politicked position to be in control on and off screen is the reason why he can do this. He can do whatever he wants. In over 25 years, The Rock hasn't much changed in his on-screen abilities. He was the fully formed, most electric man in all of sports entertainment from 2 years in. But the experience of reaching the very top of Hollywood, falling out with fellow megastar actors, the biggest of movie studios, and losing his most treasured franchises has changed the way he operates behind the scenes. He's become a very effective backstage politician. And maybe one day he'll transfer that to being an on-screen politician, as while Black Adam was bombing at the box office, Johnson claimed multiple political parties in the United States approached him to see if he would run for president, following a poll that revealed 46% of Americans would support his campaign. And count me, and I hope all of you, as in that 46%, because I am Oli Davis, and I support The Rock for President of the United States.
We're all doomed.
Okay, right, let's go all the way back up, hop over to the MyVia side, down two generations, and there we are. Rock the Dwayne Johnson. Johnson began wrestling in 1996 after his football career didn't pan out. Pat Patterson got him some WWF tryout matches.